talk about Erlang, mainly in the topic of handling the million of users, concurrent users in servers, in the backend systems. And well, first of all, I'm introduce myself. My name is Manuel Rubio. I come from Spain. And well, I started programming when I was 12 years old. And I was studying a lot of programming languages. A sample of, I was developing in Perl, Python, Ruby, before that in C, C++, Pascal. And in 2008, I arrived to the Erlang environment, the Erlang ecosystem. And in the environment I was working, that was in the server part, in the backend, that was very useful because the topics that are based for on Erlang, that is very focused on that environment. So I study system administration mainly when I was 22 years old, and I work. I wrote the first Spanish book for Erlang, and I started to work in 2004 for several companies. I was working in Finland, in France, and I work for a lot of countries now. And in 2013, I found my own company called Altenbal Solutions. And well, the Altenbal solution is a name is German. It's ancient forest, or more or less. It's based in the Tolkien forest where live Bombadil. And the base of the pillars or the main. The company is based to use or to help to another companies to implement high availability, concurrent, and distributed systems. So we use or we encourage to use Erlang OTP, and but not all the companies use it, and sometimes we improve the architecture. Improving and putting the some specific parts in Erlang OTP. Altenbal is the first Spanish company in the Industrial Erlang Users Group. That is the group that helps to Ericsson to improve and keep the code for Erlang and the ecosystem and the standards and everything. And well, we make projects mainly in GitHub. We have the space Altenbal, and we have a lot of projects you can see for build specific systems using Erlang. And well, my speech starts because well, why we need to use Erlang? If we think. Some time ago, maybe at the end of the last century, the 90s, we found that we go from the web 1.0 to the web 2.0 because the things, the web mainly, was progressing to be more interactive for the users. And this helped to us to interact with the servers, with the other people, and with the information in the internet to get things like, well, a media wiki, through the Wikipedia, for example. And we can use webmails and forums and a lot of things that are now in the internet. Well, mainly, the web dot 2.0 is about collaboration, interaction with the servers, with the information in the internet, and mainly with other people connecting to the same webs or the social networks like Facebook or another. And this was possible thanks to the first systems that was created and very populated, the internet, like the systems like LAMP was I think was the first stack that was very famous in the internet, and all the people started to use it because all the servers at the ISP start to install in the hosting and sharing the and keep the possibility to hire a LAMP system very cheap. And the easy to develop something in PHP and the possibility to use easy SQL that was the faster way to access to the data because the first version of the web was mainly reading than greeting. So the systems that are using this kind of stacks, not only LAMP, we can talk here about Ruby on Rails, Django, and whatever other. They use a web server, and mainly they use a separate server to store the information, the persistent information, in a database like MySQL or another like Postgres, or even now something like NoSQL. And when the users comes and is using the system a lot, the first step for this kind of structure is put more web servers to take in advance that we have the database in a separate server, and we can put more frontends because the PHP is the heavier part of the system and it should be replicated. But well, we have a lot of users coming from the servers, and the system is arriving to the next limit, and that's not enough. The database is not capable to handle this new limit of users, and we have to increase the platform using another trick, like replicating the database using master-slave, or maybe master-master, depends on the kind of database we use, and even use something like a queue for put some jobs in delay, at the queue delay, for do later and not in the real-time part. This kind of architectures have several issues, like for example sessions, because we have to store the sessions in another server to keep between all the web servers, and mainly the sessions used to be something that you can read and store when you finish your request. But if you do several requests at the same time, it's possible the modification for the first and second is lost, and the third is overwriting that. The replication of the database is not an easy part of the architectures because the configuration for master slaves and master master in some of the system is not clear. And we need to use sometimes something like a cache and maybe accelerators for put the code in a binary state, like for example the optimizations that gave us Facebook with the hip hop virtual machine, or accelerators like APC for PHP, or another accelerators in Python and Ruby. And as I told in the last, the queues for asynchronous process is more frequent now because of the statistics, information, and even payments. There are a lot of infrastructures that had to put that in queues to avoid the flood when the users are very active. And the concurrency is hard to do, or sometimes impossible, because there are a lot of issues. We have to put some semaphores, techniques like semaphores and synchronization of a process that decrease the performance of the system a lot. And WebSockets in some of the stacks now is impossible and impracticable. So we arrived to Erlang, and well, the first question is what is Erlang? Well, Erlang is a mix between a language and a platform, because the people that created in the Ericsson laboratories wants to get a solution for the switching calls in the 1986 year, and they need thousands of calls in only one machine, can be interchanged handling without problems or to make problems or to the rest of the processor and the calls in the system. And that was the main purpose for them was create the platform, the virtual machine, that has its own scheduler for manage more than 1 million of processes. If you think about, for example, Linux, the Unix systems, and even the Windows, the scheduling and managing the process is only 32,000 of processes, or even 64,000 of processes, and not more. That is the main problem, because if you have a lot of calls, a lot of requests, a lot of information that should be handled at the same moment, it's not possible, because we have not enough processes to work. And in the Ericsson laboratories, they thought about we can handle this problem, letting the system create a lot of processes. Now, in whatever Erlang virtual machine, it's possible to create even the 100 million of processes. And of course, they had its own memory management. As a virtual machine, they has its own command line interpreter, and they put the emphasis in this platform to put to the possibility to have not only one machine, but also more than one, and the communication between them should be transparent. In the way that if I have one machine with a lot of processes and I want to scale because the memory is not enough in the machine, or the network is too low, we can put another machine, and the communication between them is transparent, and the code can use the memory and the process scheduling from both machines and balance the processes between them. And finally, the features of the Erlang, as I told, is the system is distributed, because we can handle the processes between a lot of machines, we can connect the machines, and we can play creating processes across them only from the same command interpreter. command line interpreter. It's fault tolerant because the processes are isolated, share nothing. So if one process dies, the other processes is not affected. So the system is working well, and we can develop supervisors to relaunch the process again. And this is, I think, is the only one the system that let us to do the hot code swapping. Because, for example, in interpreted languages, you can put another part of code, another script, another source code for be interpreted in the next calls. But if you are only a lot of source files, like, for example, Magento in PHP has millions of files there. If you go to do an upgrade, for example, you can take between two or five minutes to do all the change, and the calls, the requests in the meantime is taking the code from the first and the second version. So this change is not very clear. And for example, Erlang put all the code, all the new code in the directory. And when the calls for the new code is done, the modules select the last version of the module that should be used in that moment, and use the new code instead of the old one. So select the way to do the change of the code in the moment that is using the next call to the next function. So the code is swapping progressively. Well, and the question why Erlang fits better in this kind of stages or scenarios? This is a try that did Joe Armstrong, that was the creator of the language, using JAWS, that is a web server, Erlang OTP, is a Erlang OTP web server, and a page created, compiled in two ways, using workers, 250 threads in the first one, and 64 processes in the second one. The second one is pre-fork, so generates processes in the real operating system. And you can see, for example, the throughput and the calls that is handling by the three systems. The x-axis is related to the simultaneous calls that is attending the systems. And if you realize, the green and the blue are stopping at even before than the 5,000. So that means that when Apache arrives to 5,000 of calls, it's not attending more requests. It's returning 500 kind of errors, or it's not responding anymore. But JAWS in this case is keeping until more or less 85,000 of concurrent calls. This is a show that this kind of paradigm of develop is better for this kind of scenarios or this kind of test, because it's capable to, in the same machine, to handle more calls, a bit slower, but isn't always responsive. And this was the main reason, because the people in the telco and banks are starting to use it. And about the speed, and is faster, is slow. Well, one disadvantage of Erlang is in the old benchmarks, is a bit slower than the rest. But this is because the specific part of Erlang was developed thinking about was capable to handle all the calls that arise to the system, not think about the speed. So Steve Schwartz said that phrase about this topic, and says that well, this is not about to run faster. This is about to get wider routes to get more processes run at once. And some use cases, for example, the most famous is WhatsApp, that is using Jabberd, that is wrote in Erlang. And well, when WhatsApp was bought by Facebook, Erlang grew as grew very fast because all the people put the focus in Erlang and wants to know what is that. And for example, this was a recent publication in Wired about why WhatsApp use Erlang and why they use Erlang with only 50 engineers handling 900 or million of users. That for American people is unthinkable. Is not possible because all the enterprise has measured if they had 1 million of users, they should have a lot of engineers to handle that. So if you think about this date, this data, about only 50 engineers, and of them only 10 are Erlang developers. How is possible? They handle all the system thinking about these 1900 of millions, and there are a lot of servers to handle. They speak, well, the main of the developers speak, ask the question in the publication of Wired, and say that, well, it's about use agile methodologies. Okay, and it's because the Erlang syntax is very easy, and if you say the code, it's a shorter code, it's easy to see if there are errors, and it's easy to improve, and it's easy to work with it. So it's not needed to have a big infrastructure for a long department with a lot of engineers because it's not needed with these kind of languages. And another recent publication about League of Legends, that is a video game from PC, is about how they are capable to handle a lot of users, and even this is the first company that is capable to use more than 1,000 of users in the same chat room. So for video games, this was a bit innovative because was 99% of uptime, 67 million of unique players a month. A lot of are huge numbers to handle in the systems, and they are using Jabberd in the same way that WhatsApp. But okay, they had to do a lot of improvements in WhatsApp, and they do in this publication, for example, explain about how they modify the code of Jabberd to gain the, or to achieve. More than 1,000 of users in the same chat room. And well, this is a collection of stamps. Who is using Erlang OTP at this moment? Ericsson, of course, because they build it. Motorola, Telia, and T-Mobile, that are in the same row, are telco companies. Klarna, in the corner, there are the first micropayment company that start to use it, and it's the longer company that has the longer department of Erlang developers. And Amazon use it in the routing system to handle all the calls to HTTP. Facebook used it for hand the deployment of the systems using the opscode software. Machine Zoom, Spiel Games, Singa use it for develop the part of the chat, even the part of the communication between the users and the servers. Demon War, that is the blue one, this part, is the company that is related to Blizzard and Activision and has or handle the part of the servers for titles like Skylanders or Call of Duty. And well, there are Rackspace, Heroku, Woga, Opscode, and of course WhatsApp, and Jungla, Levara. Enterprise like they use Erlang mainly for telco or for chat mainly, and for transactions like Klarna. And what is made in Erlang OTP? I think a lot of people use some of them, and they didn't realize that wow, this is in Erlang. But for example, RabbitMQ, I remember that was the first system that replaced the JMEs in the Enterprise Service Bus system for Java, because the way that I handle all the messages in the system that requires a lot of information interchange between the systems was handled better with RabbitMQ than others. And well, Couchbase and React, there are new NoSQL databases. And Chef starts in the first versions like Ruby server and Ruby client to deployments, automation deployments. And in the 11th version, with the support of Facebook, change from Ruby in the server to Erlang, and has a lot of keynotes from the engineers explaining what was the advantage to do the change. And well, this is Erlang OTP around the world and job opportunities, because in Erlang Central, that is the main site we use to put information about Erlang and put job opportunities and a lot of more information. All the companies that start to use Erlang OTP put their job opportunities, and I made this map to give a fast view and an overview about where is the main use of this kind of languages now. And well, you can see that it's in the North America, the north of Europe, and even now in India and China, was where this kind of technologies emerge fast. And well, now I'll try to explain why Erlang is better for this kind of activities or this kind of task, and why the languages that is developed now is not fitting well with this kind of the task we have to do in the server part. Well, mainly I remember until Pentium 4, all the microprocessor was fast, and take a lot of earth. And suddenly, when appears the first system with two cores, the system goes back and put less earth and more cores. And now we can find systems, microprocessors with a lot of cores, 64, 128. And the telco companies, or maybe the companies like AMD or Intel, realized that the problem of to solve now is not the speed, it's the capability to do a lot of things at the same time. So in this paradigm, in 1977, Carl Hewitt based his studies about the actor model that is now in hype because it's used in systems like Scala and others. Carl Hewitt put on the table the possibility to use something like object-oriented programming, but a step more. He needs to put a lot of microprocessors to work together, and the microprocessors he wants has its own memory and has its own microprocessor to do tasks and talk between them. So the oriented programming, the object-oriented programming text that was written by Alan Kahn was very useful for him, because the first draft from Alan Kahn was based on the passing messages between the objects and no calls internally, that is done now with the object-oriented programming languages. And they use that approach, but put more strong in the, for example, encapsulation. This is not possible to access to the memory. You can only access to the information that has the actor if you request them through the message. So you send a message, you request, hey, I want some information. And it's like people, you want the information from other one, you have to ask. And the other people can ignore, that is because it's an asynchronous model, or can wait to get the better moment to give an answer. That led us to do a lot of questions and do the same, do the rest of the task the system should be in that moment. And Erlang took that approach from Carl Hewitt and started to develop the actor model itself as was in the document. But the main objective was, for example, if you see the development model in the object-oriented programming, is you can put, for example, there are three threads, and the object that's utilizing in several threads, and one thread can access to the information in the other thread, and what is it's not shorted, but it's, in the actor model, one process has its own memory, its own heap with the information, and it's run in the same process that has the code, the memory, and the mailbox to recite the messages from the others. Well, about the syntax, Jan Strostrup says something the intelligent, because well, in that moment all the people complains about C++ and about the syntax. You think about that years was the years of Pascal, for example, and Niklaus Wirth, for example, was complaining about this C language because he used symbols instead of words. So Jan Strostrup says that there are only two kinds of languages, languages that the people complain and the languages that is not used at all. And for express the Erlang system syntax, I want to put a typical example of factorial, because for example in the computer science we learned this is a basic computer algorithm. We thought that the factorial of 0 is 1, the factorial of 1 is 1, the 2 is 2 per 1, and we can advance in an iteration model. If we wrote, this in C, for example, we get something similar to this. And you are explaining to the machine step by step what should be done using, for example, the E variable as iterator, and accumulating the information in the F variable. And finally, we can return the result. If you think on this, you think this is easy, you can raise your hands. Okay, is this? Well, this is not easy. If you are an experienced programmer, you see that and it's easy for you because you learned C a long time ago. But if you see this for the first time, you realize that this is an algorithm, a math algorithm, and this is a recipe about the steps to achieve that algorithm. This is a bit more clear because it's recursive and it's lesser, but this is very complex too for the people that start to develop in C. And finally, this is the example in Erlang. We say that 0 is 1, 1 is 1, and n is n per factorial n minus 1. This is simple and more similar to the original algorithm, because we are telling to the system what we want, not how to obtain the information. And in this algorithm, for example, there are an error. If you see, well, if you use 0, for example, this is not returning this is not returning 1, it's returning 0. So the error is not, well, you cannot realize if the algorithm is right or not, because it's not easy to read. In this kind of algorithms, if the first I have a 0, it's easy to see. And another language features, for example, we have immutable states. I say, as in maths, if A is bind to 1, it's not possible to bind to 2. It's an exception. A has its value and is 1. It's not possible to A in the second step is 2. This is worth very much because this when you are reading the algorithm and you see the value is assigned in the first step, for example, you know that that value should be the same in the rest of the algorithm. So it's easy to track. The simple language, because for example, Rust language has 7 kind of structures to write code. In Erlang, we have only 4: case, if, try catch, and resize. And the most use is case. The rest is used only in not often cases. And we use a lot this kind of case structures, for example, is based on match. For example, if value is 12, you return that. If value is whatever, but is an integer, you return OK. But is whatever else, you return fail. And we are using the message passing, that is different kind of blocks or locks, because we are basing the interchange of information in the pace, the message pacing, and the structure of the language, the syntax includes, for example, exclamation, like the symbol specific to send the information to the another bit. You can spawn processes easily with spawn, and you can do in whatever moment in the code, and a lot of times, because you have more than 1 million of processes to generate. And the resize is to get the response from the other process if the other process sends a message in response. So you can send a message and put a receive or not. You can send a cast instead of a conversation, a synchronization for that. Well, and long, very long numbers. A sample for the factorial I use. You say the first one is the factorial of 128, and that is the result. And if you say you run the factorial of 1024, you can get that. I got the numbers because it was very long. But the numbers in Erlang is as long as you have enough memory to store it. That is the reason because the bank systems are incorporating this kind of things, because the simple integers are very, very long, and you can use it with a lot of precision. Matching, for example, you can use that. This is very useful. For example, the last sample is about open a PNG file and get the information about the length of the file, the width, height, depth of the colors and color, compression, filter, interlace. In that lines, you can get all the information about the PNG. If you know the composition of the header of the files. You can do that with the protocols in the internet, for example, to trace or get, for example, an HTTP request or another protocols, or to get information from files, as you can see there. And, well, things like list, using sets, and behaviors. Actor model is based on behaviors. Behaviors is the base, or like in object-oriented programming, you can see the base classes. Here are the base behaviors. The inheritance is simple. You can only get one or two behaviors, or three, whatever behaviors that are compatible with them, between them. And the most used is server. You can generate, put the behavior of server in your module, and put the specific implementation of the functions, and create a server with in an easy way. The second one is finite state machines. It's very useful for example, in Jabberday for users. Every user, when they log to the system, create a finite state machine that puts in the state of authentication, goes to interchange of features, and goes to session established. Generation of events that can be used with event handlers, supervisors. We can use to put a three of supervisors, because if one process dies, you can generate a new one, and the system continues working. And the base of the application. As I said before, Erlang is a platform, it's a virtual machine, and it's based in the, you can create applications, and the application is packaged and put in the Erlang virtual machine, and you can start all the applications you need to create your whole application system. You can get dependencies from GitHub, for example, to put HTTP server, for example, and generate the code you need for do a REST code, for example. And the application you wrote is using another application that is in the virtual machine. And a complete example about a finite state machine. This is a scheme about the B is the ground floor, the one is the first floor, and the two is the second floor. It's simulating an elevator, and you can press the up button in every floor and go to the next one, and you can press the down button and go to the previous one. If you see the code, we use the behavior definite state machine to implement the state machine that you can see here. And we implement with the name of the functions, ground floor, first floor, and second floor. When the message arrives, can be up or down, we move the elevator based on the information that we have. For example, if we init in ground floor, that is the init function, we go to the ground floor. So we initiate the state in the ground floor. If we press up, in this case, we move to the first floor, that is the next state defined there. And if we press down in the ground floor, it's an error that and keep us in the ground floor. This is a real code for a finite state machine, and this works well. And well, there are more complex samples for finite state machines, but this is a short sample I can show you. And if you want to get more information about Erlang, this is the books that is available now about Erlang in the in books stores and from different editorials. And even if you want to use the Erlang platform, but you want to use another language like, for example, Elixir, there are another collection of books because the Erlang platform is the base, and other languages can use the same good things that have the Erlang platform. Now, at this moment, there are a Lisp simulator, the Erlang language, and Elixir. And you can see more information about my company in Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, and or GitHub. Questions? Yes.